Hello friends, I'm Vikram Joy, your host for the show Health and Living. A renowned cardiologist who's worked for over 25 years with PGI, he is currently the director of cardiology at Fortis Healthcare here in Mohali. Dr. Bali has an extensive experience of performing both elective and emergency coronary interventions. He has received several national and international awards and recognitions, including the prestigious DP Basu Young Investigators Award. So, I welcome Dr. H.K. Bali. Welcome, Dr. Sir.
Thank you, Vikram.
Dr. Sir, let's start from the basics, basic reasons for the increase in heart diseases in the society today.
Vikram ji, if you look at heart disease in India, or for that matter in world, it's increasing at a very, very rapid rate.
Yes.
In fact, in India, we would have something like 60 million people suffering from heart disease.
My God.
And many of them are not aware of it.
Mm-hmm.
And it is increasing, we call it a lifestyle disease. And it's increasing because our lifestyle has not become as, is not, no more as healthy as it should be. Our diet is defective. We are no more taking exercise. Physical activity is very low, and stress has increased significantly. So these three factors in a major way contribute to the increasing heart disease in India.
Okay. So what is angina, Dr. Sahab? Like we call heart attack. So what is angina?
See, there's a little difference between angina and heart attack.
Okay.
Basically, heart is a muscle, is a pump.
Okay.
And it needs blood supply to function. That blood supply is given to it by arteries, coronary arteries. We call them coronary arteries. Now, when the block starts occurring in these coronary arteries, the blood supply to the heart muscle is decreased. And this initially manifests on physical activity or emotional disturbances. Any activity which would increase the work of heart muscle would bring up these symptoms. And when these symptoms come on exercise, we call it angina. That means a person would take exercise for walk for about 5 to 7 minutes. He will have discomfort in the chest. He sits down for a period of time, a few minutes, and he would be all right. So this cycle is repeated. This is what we call as a angina. And heart attack is when one of the major of these arteries, epicardial arteries, gets completely blocked. So when the artery is blocked, the muscle which is supplied by that artery over a period of time undergoes damage. And this damage, when it occurs, this is what we call as a heart attack. So heart attack occurs because of a complete blockage of the artery. Angina occurs when the block is subtotal, and only when the requirement of the heart is increased, these symptoms come up.
But does that mean that angina is the initial?
It is a precursor of heart attack. So many people have angina for a period of time, and then they go on to develop heart attack.
And that frequency of angina increases over the period of time.
Yes, this is what we call as an unstable angina.
Okay.
Now, supposing somebody is getting an angina for walking for about 2 kilometers or so, and then suddenly over a period of few days, this duration of walking decreases, or the duration of pain which he is getting starts getting increases a lot, and this period of instability we call as an unstable angina. We also call it as a pre-heart attack. Because that indicates that the person is going to get a heart attack. So we have stable coronary artery disease, which we call as angina pectoris. We have unstable coronary artery disease, which is unstable angina. And we have heart attack, which we call as a myocardial infarction. Or in layman term, we call it a dil ka dora.
Okay. So angina can also be cured, in the sense, can be taken care of.
Yes, basically we have treatment for angina. We treat them by medicine.
It can be rectified.
Yes. Even heart attack can be prevented also and can be taken care of.
Yes. That is true. That we'll discuss in the further questions. So, what are the causes of angina or heart attack? Not angina. I mean, what are the causes of heart attack?
See, the same processes which cause angina cause heart attack. So, what happens is when the block occurs in the coronary artery,
mm-hmm.
this block we call it a plaque. Medical term, we call it a plaque.
Okay.
So it is basically an atheromatous cholesterol rich material which gets deposited inside the coronary artery. And then this plaque gets ruptured and leads to a complete occlusion of the artery. Now, the same factors which initially caused angina, like lack of physical activity, like stress, like diet, they play a major role. But other factors like cholesterol, hypercholesterolemia, like smoking, obesity, family history. So these are factors which contribute to angina and heart attack. We call them non-modifiable factors, which we cannot modify, like genetic factors. So in some families, you would see that there is a young people in the age of 35 to 40, multiple members get a heart attack.
Yes.
So we call it a genetic factor. There's a genetic predisposition, which we cannot modify.
Okay.
As long as the patient ages, the person ages, the older we become, there's a more chance of getting a heart disease and heart attack. And that is, these are unmodifiable factors. But there are certain modifiable risk factors, which we can actually take care of. Like, which I said, hypercholesterolemia, diabetes, smoking, obesity, and all those factors we can modify. And it's a lifestyle disease. All these factors are lifestyle factors. And if we modify them, we can actually prevent or slow down the process of disease.
So, doctor, what are the basically symptoms of a heart attack?
The symptoms of heart attack are that, you know, retrosternal. We have a central bone in our chest, which we call as a sternum. So retrosternal, there is a discomfort. And discomfort is diffuse. And this is like a pressure or a compression which occurs over the center of the chest.
Okay.
Unlike to what we normally common people believe, okay, that's on the left side, because the heart is on the left side.
Yes.
Most of the heart disease occur in the, there's a compression or a pressure on the center of the chest.
Okay.
And it increases, it goes to both the shoulders, one shoulder or other shoulder to the back, and sometime to the lower jaw. So this discomfort lasts for a period of 10 to 15 minutes. And it is associated with sweating, some breathing difficulty. So if it lasts for 15-20 minutes, then a heart attack is a likely possibility. What we need to remember is that this pain of heart attack is never a pinprick. If somebody says that I have a pinprick which is coming and going, it's not likely to be heart attack.
Okay.
Similarly, if somebody points with a finger that I have got a pain in this part of the my chest, it is unlikely to be a heart attack. So therefore, there are symptoms which, by which we can differentiate this. And then pain of heart attack does not go above the lower jaw. The pain of heart attack does not go below the navel. So this is the area which we get, a diffuse discomfort, which many people describe as a compression, or as if somebody has put a weight on the center part of the chest. Very few people in fact say that I have pain, because this discomfort is a little different from what we get a pain. So discomfort in the center part of chest, associated with the symptoms like sweating, breathlessness, and breathing difficulty. So all those symptoms we say that a heart attack may be coming up.
Okay. So when should a patient actually seek medical advice, and how do you diagnose a heart attack?
See, heart attack diagnosis is very simple. A simple ECG would give you a diagnosis of a heart attack.
Yes.
And we believe that a patient who is suffering from heart attack or thinks he has got a heart attack should get medical advice in the shortest possible time. Because we believe the shorter time is taken to open up that blocked artery, the better results would be there. We believe heart is time is muscle. That means the more time is lost, more heart muscle would get damaged, and that would have not immediate complication, but it will also have long-term complication. So we want that once the artery is blocked, that means the onset of the heart attack, to the time when we actually open up the artery by whatever technique, by drugs, which we call as the clot busters, or by angioplasty, which we call as a primary angioplasty, should be very short. We believe that it should be not more than 1 hour in case of a clot busters, from the onset of symptoms, from what we call as a door to needle time. That means from the onset of heart attack to the time when a person actually get a clot buster should not be more than 1 hour.
Okay.
And it should not be more than 90 minutes if we are taking him to the cath lab and doing a primary angioplasty. Beyond that, every half an hour, there is more and more damage. So the shorter the time, better it is.
The better it
is. So we actually believe that patient should report to the emergency immediately.
Okay.
And there are many centers where we would like to give treatment in the ambulance to cut down on this time period. We also believe that in emergency as well, when a patient comes, we should cut out on the paperwork and take him to the cath lab immediately. So that the time is not lost in paperwork or taking all those, doing all those formalities. So we can open up the artery in the shortest possible time. If we are able to do this, then we can actually abort a heart attack.
Okay.
The damage may not occur. So time is of extreme essence in this.
Importance, yes. So what is the treatment for heart attack? These are, yeah, every case is different.
You know, when the onset of heart attack is there, a patient feels that I am getting a heart attack, we advise that he should take an aspirin tablet, chew a tablet of aspirin, 300 milligram of tablet of aspirin,
okay.
And he should take a nitrate. Many families have nitrate, sorbitrate, what we call it.
Sorbitrate.
Yes. He should take a tablet of sorbitrate sublingually, repeat it in 5 minutes, another tablet. But if there is no response, then he should come to the emergency.
Okay.
And we believe that the most important treatment for heart attack is to open up by primary angioplasty. That means take him to the cath lab, do an angiography, identify the culprit vessel which is causing heart attack,
okay,
and open it up with a balloon angioplasty and stenting. But that may not be possible in large number of people in our country.
Yeah.
Because we believe that, you know, where there are remote areas, where this facility may not be available, or the time, lot of time may be lost.
Yes.
So for them, clot buster, thrombolytic treatment is effective. We have very safe drugs these days, which can be given as an injection,
mm-hmm,
over a period of 5 to 10 minutes. And it has about 60 to 70% of efficacy as compared to angioplasty. So we give thrombolytic treatment, people would respond, and then the patient should be shifted to a center where angioplasty can be performed. We call it a pharmaco-invasive treatment.
Okay.
That means we give medical treatment, clot busters, then shift him for an angioplasty. And we also believe that if the, supposing the shifting is less than 2 hours, supposing somebody gets it in Ambala or some surrounding area which is the journey is involving less than 2 hours, then the patient should may actually be shifted for primary angioplasty. But if the time duration is going to be more than 2 hours, for whatever reason, the ambulance is not available, or there's traffic, or the place is too far away, then give a clot buster, and after giving clot buster, shift him for an invasive treatment like we call the angioplasty. So we have pharmacological treatment in the form of clot busters.
Okay.
We have angioplasty as an interventional treatment, and a large majority would get a pharmaco-invasive treatment. A clot buster first, and then shift to a center where an angioplasty can be performed. The basic idea is to open the artery in the shortest possible time so that we can prevent heart muscle damage.
Right. So, doctor, how do we prevent heart attack basically? Is it only life, lifestyle disorder or?
Yeah, I think most important factor is we take care of the modifiable risk factors. That means we take care of hypertension, diabetes, smoke. I think in the present era, nobody should be smoking.
Yes.
It's actually a crime to smoke.
Yes.
So take care of diabetes, hypertension, cholesterol, and then do exercise regularly,
mm-hmm,
daily exercise, and take care of your diet. If all these five factors are taken care of, then we can prevent it to a very large extent. We also advise that if you are beyond 40 years of age,
yes,
then preventive health check is important. That should include, absolutely.
Yeah.
That should include cholesterol checking, all the parameters of cholesterol, good cholesterol,
uric
bad
acid,
cholesterol,
uric acid,
blood sugar testing,
okay,
and doing a TMT, treadmill test, or an echocardiography. So these non-invasive tests would diagnose heart disease at an early stage, when we can actually treat them without any problem. So beyond 40 years, everyone should have a preventive health checkup. We also advise that if you have a very strong family history, I mean, more than two members in the family have suffered a heart disease at less than 40 years of age, then the person should get this all these risk factors checked and exercise and TMT test at 35 years.
Okay.
So that is where we want to be a little more aggressive than in normal people.
Dr. Sir, you've done many breakthroughs and interventions. I would like you to share some of them with our viewers.
See, I do coronary angioplasties. I do other angioplasty stenting also, like carotid angioplasty stenting. Then I put in stent grafts for aneurysms in the arteries. I also look after heart failure patient and treat them by devices. But most of the innovations which I have done have been in the field of coronary angioplasty. And in coronary angioplasty, we have found some new techniques by which we can take care of very complicated coronary lesions. I recently described a new technique for taking care of ostial coronary artery disease. Ostial is where the coronary artery is actually starting.
Okay.
Now, doing angioplasty stenting of ostial lesion had been tough till recently. So I described a new technique by which we can safely treat this thing with a very good long-term result. I presented this innovative technique in the recently held TCT. TCT is one of the largest interventional cardiology meeting in the world. So I presented that data there. Similarly, I have also innovated a new device by which we can do an angioplasty through a bloodless technique. You will appreciate that many people are suffering from blood diseases,
yes,
which may be infective, like hepatitis B or C or even some HIV or other things, which may be a risk to the operators. So I described a new technique where we can do an angioplasty with a bloodless technique. So it's a simple technique, devised from normally available things in the cath lab, and without a drop of blood being coming in touch with the patient or the attendant or the operator, we can do the procedure completely. So we are getting that patented as well. Similarly, there are complicated procedures we do, like bifurcations and other things, where I have contributed to innovating some techniques.
So you've done so much for the society, Dr. Sahab. I really feel that our viewers will learn a lot from this episode of Health and Living. Thank you so much, Dr. Bali. It was wonderful. It was an honor to have you here at our Daily World Studios in Chandigarh. Thank you, Dr. Sahab.
Thank you, Vikramji. I would say that our objective is that so many new techniques are coming up worldwide.
Yes.
New drugs are coming worldwide.
Yes, yes.
How we can change these advances which are occurring in cardiology to common man, to the poor people, to people in remote areas at an affordable price? That is the biggest challenge which we face, and that is where we all are working towards. If we can get that technology to reach to common people, I would feel that we have done something for the society.
I'm sure we will. One day it will be very useful for every common man of this country and the society.
Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. Thank you so much. So that was Dr. H.K. Bali for us this week. See you in another episode of Health and Living.